A very good evening to everyone. Thank you for taking out the time and joining us to celebrate Earth Day 2021. Today's webinar takes you on a stunning adventure to the snowy mountains of Kashmir, where our team works very hard in the field of wildlife conservation. Leading the project and today's webinar is our project manager for the Jammu Kashmir project, Ms. Alia Mir. During the course of the webinar, I request everyone to please keep their mics on mute and their cameras off. Please drop your questions only in the question and answer box along with your name and your email ID. We will be taking questions at the end of the webinar, and if we are unable to get to any question, we will be emailing you the responses separately. Thank you so much for joining us once again. Over to you, Alia ma'am.
So hi everyone, hope you all are good, in good health. I'm Alia Mir and I work as project manager for Wildlife SOS in Jammu and Kashmir. A warm welcome to you all on behalf of whole Wildlife SOS team towards an insight of the efforts that Wildlife SOS is putting in the conservation of wildlife in this part of the world, which is Jammu and Kashmir. As you all might be knowing, that our region, Kashmir, it's famous for its lofty mountains, meadow valleys, lush green forests, fascinating lakes, rivers, and streams, unending varieties of landscapes, as you can see from the picture as well, and rich biodiversity that makes this part of the world literally a paradise on earth. And the richness of habitats and ecosystems add to the diversity of our wildlife. Of the total erstwhile geographical area of Jammu and Kashmir, which is 42,241 square kilometers, 4,777 kilometers comes under the protected area network, which comprises of 4 national parks, 13 wildlife sanctuaries, 15 conservation reserves, and 14 wetland reserves, out of which Hokarsar Wetland Reserve is recognized as the Ramsar site in 2005. And this Hokarsar wetland is also known as the queen of all wetlands of Kashmir. Whereas I was talking about the national parks, we have 4 national parks in Jammu and Kashmir, 1 in Jammu and 3 in Kashmir. Whereas Dachigam National Park, having the area of 141 square kilometers, stretches from the length and breadth of Kashmir, and it is considered country's one of the best national parks. Owing to the diversity of all altitudes, which ranges from 1600 meters to 5500 meters, and of course, climatic variations, we have a diverse landscapes in Kashmir, like we have Himalayan moist temperate forests, we have broadleaf deciduous forests, we have evergreen forest, riverine forest, subtropical pine, subalpine and alpine forests. We have grasslands too. And that is owing to the diversity in wild flora and wild fauna of this region. So as you can see from the pictures, there is brown bear. We have 2 of the mightiest bears found in Jammu and Kashmir. The brown bear, which is the subspecies of the grizzly bear, and the Himalayan black bears, which are known one of the most aggressive bears of the world. And here you can see in the another picture, we have snow leopards, which are very rare in the whole world. And then we have, hangul, which is a unique species found only in Kashmir, and the last abode of these unique species called hangul, Kashmir red deer, is the Dachigam National Park. So including these, we have markhor, we have western tragopan, we have musk deer, we have many other unique species which are, you know, very special and hold a special place in our state. All these animals are Schedule 1 animals. But unfortunately, man-animal interface is the bitter reality of this beautiful place. As we all know that wild animals are in the state of conflict in almost all parts of the world, and Jammu and Kashmir is no exception. Here in Jammu and Kashmir, apart from leopards, porcupines, monkeys, wild boars, bears are in the state of conflict with humans. But more than 80% of these conflicts are because of the black bears, that being the reason that today I'll be discussing about the conflicts specified to black bears and the leopards. So here you can see that we are losing our loved ones, we are losing our wildlife wealth, we are losing the wealth of the people, their crops, their livestock, etc. This is the data which is with the Wildlife Protection Department, and it is the authorized data. According to this data, during the years 2006 and 2018, which means 12 years, it shows that 221 human deaths and more than 3,000 human casualties, because human wildlife conflict. And as I mentioned before, that 80% of these cases are because of the human black bear conflicts, and others because of the leopards. The records from SKIMS Hospital, which is the only super specialty hospital in the Kashmir Valley, it shows that 10 to 15% of total bed occupancy in plastic surgery ward at any given time of the year is due to the black bear maul cases, with 96.7% patients from young to middle age group. Because the target group of bear conflicts were predominantly adult males working in the fields, as most of the human black bear conflicts, they take place in the agricultural lands. So that's why most of the males who are working in the fields, they get injured or they get killed during the black bear conflicts. Whereas the target groups in leopard cases were predominantly females and children, because leopard always attack with the intention to kill. Whereas black bears, their intention is not to kill the humans. Their intention is just to make themselves safe, and that's why they attack in retaliation. So before going further with the facts and figures of this human wildlife conflict, we first need to understand what conflict is and what are the reasons behind these conflicts. Does mere sighting of an animal in the human habitation means conflict? No. It is well defined as any interaction between humans and wildlife that results in negative impacts on humans' social, economic, or cultural life, and on the conservation of wildlife populations or on the environment. And it is very well defined by Madden in 2004 that human-wildlife conflict occurs when the needs and behavior of wildlife impact negatively on the goals of humans, or when the goals of humans negatively impact the needs of wildlife. And I must tell you that last two decades have seen enormous increase in human-wildlife conflicts, mainly due to demographic changes placing more people in direct contact with the animals, encroachment of forest lands and wastelands, decimation of forest cover, change in land use pattern in which, conversion of prime habitats into croplands, into orchards, and of course, in some cases, into human settlements as well. So all these things have taken place, and they are, you know, contributing towards the increment in these human wildlife conflicts. And yes, change in cropping pattern is one more reason that's contributing towards this. There is increase in livestock that acts as an attractant for the carnivores to come towards these human habitations. Then there is, you know, unnatural food conditioning of the animals. And believe me that these food conditioned animals are more responsible, you know, in the human wildlife conflict. Then there are climatic changes, which have in turn changed the animal behavior. And of course, occupation of forests by security forces and armed forces, as you all aware that this part of the world is politically little sensitive. So there are, you know, much of the security force and armed forces who hold the sensitive places where although they, you know, act as deterrent to poachers and hunters, but however, their presence causes disturbances to the habitat of the wildlife. This conflict takes the most ugly turn when we lose our loved ones or when our animal wealth gets killed. Crop damage by wild animals is probably one of the most widespread and persistent form of human wildlife conflict. And such damage adversely impacts, you know, staple food grains and non-food crops and commercial crops. Like in this part of the world, we have apple trees and other berry trees, cherry trees, you know, and the damage results not only from animals feeding on crops, but also from trampling and rooting, uprooting of these plants and these trees and other forms of wastage, and in destruction of commercial crops that may take, you know, several years to reestablish. Like, as I talked about the fruit trees, if they are uprooted or broken by the wild bears, you know, they will take next 10 to 15 years to become the full-fledged trees that could yield them a good produce. Another severe, you know, effect of these human wildlife conflict is the loss of our livestock and domesticated animals, which are killed by black bears or leopards. And it's again a serious problem because, you know, these attacks leave the poor herders with a great economic loss, because they don't kill a single animal. They kill huge number of livestock in one go. And there are so many incidents like these happening nowadays. But human wildlife conflict attains its most serious form when people are injured or killed by the animals. The people who survive these attacks are left with grave scars, losing either their sense organs or their limbs, and making them socially and economically isolated. I have myself seen so many cases. I have been to the plastic surgery ward of the hospitals, and you know, their injuries are so grievous that I believe that they must be thinking why they are, you know, left, or why they survive these attacks. They must be cursing the time when they survive these attacks. So, you know, this helpless situation makes you so sad and more inclined that we have to make a difference in this scenario. And yes, I must also tell you that this is not all. It is also learned that every year about 6 to 8 bears get killed in retaliatory action from angry mob, and that makes us lose our animal wealth, and which makes them vulnerable to extinction. So that's why we argue that this human wildlife conflict in the valley is the biggest threat to the conservation of wildlife in the region of Jammu and Kashmir. Because if we don't you know, help people to be safe, to safeguard their crop and livestock, their negative negative attitude, their growing negative attitude towards wildlife may ultimately hinder our conservation and welfare efforts. So yes, this is the biggest threat to the existence of the wildlife in the valley. To counter this alarming situation in the valley, Wildlife SOS conducted a survey on the increasing human wild animal conflict in the valley and observed the following, following basic things, that awareness on wildlife among people is a high priority. That's too low in, awareness about wildlife is too low in the local masses. So enhancing their knowledge, enhancing their awareness is a high priority activity, and it requires increased attention, because 90% of the people are unaware of the actual root cause of the human wildlife conflict, such as occupying humans occupying wildlife habitats. They are, reached to the fringes of the forests, encroachment of the wastelands, livestock competing with the prey base for limited grass resources, which is leading to the reduction in wild prey base for the predators like leopards. Wild animals becoming conditioned to ease of obtaining high caloric food from the human encampments. Poor vigilance over herds, that is the another reason that people are not aware of, There is a poor construction of livestock pens, which people are not aware of, that they could help us to reduce this livestock depredation. And then there are climatic factor and global warming, which has led to lengthening of the annual period of bear activity, and which in turn has no doubt also contributed to the increased human bear interface, and to perception of the people, which is obviously wrong, that bear numbers are increasing rapidly. Until and unless there is a proper census of the species, we cannot, say that. But this is the notion in the people's mind, that bears are increasing day by day. So this is the level of knowledge people are having. So we need to enhance their knowledge so that we could, change their attitude. Then capacity building of local communities and frontline staff of the Wildlife Protection Department needs to be strengthened, because although the department, the Wildlife Protection Department of the state of Jammu and Kashmir state, they have the equipments, but they lack the training, they lack the skill to use those equipments. So we need to, enhance and strengthen their capacity building so that they could be the best person who could deal with the mob, who could deal with the animal rescue, and, in turn help to make an effort towards the mitigation of this man-animal conflict. And then there is the need for rescue and relocating or rehabilitation of conflicting animals. So Wildlife SOS signed the MOU with the J&K Wildlife Protection Department in July 2007. Here you can see, this is the bear under our rescue center, in our rehabilitation center. The goals, when we started in 2007, we started with two types of goals, the immediate goals and the long-term goals, because we had to take some quick actions as it was, like a crisis-like situation those days, with conflicts happening everywhere, and we worked with some immediate goals of rescue and rehabilitating of these conflicting animals and capacity building of frontline staff. Because as I said, that the department had the equipments, but they had no skilled manpower. So the rescue team had to turn up empty handed from the conflicting situations because of the lack of the skill and the training. which obviously led the bad relationship between the department and the locals. And the people lost faith in the department. They had lost faith in the department. So, you know, this made us to set our long-term goals of improving the overall awareness on the wildlife conservation in the state, because we understand that, you know, without awareness, there will be no concern, and without concern, there will be no action. So that was a basic motive towards the overall awareness of the local populace in the valley. And definitely bringing a positive change in the attitude of common masses was very important, because, you know, enhancement in the knowledge of the local masses would definitely help to bring a change in their attitude. And if their attitude is changed, that will definitely bring a change in, you know, in their behavior towards wildlife. So that was, although that is, you know, time consuming process, but we had a good faith in this, you know, theory. But we started with all these long-term goals, and yes, bridging the gap between the people and the concerned authorities was must, because connecting people and the department was important, because this is a team effort, and unless and until we don't have the you know, support and the belief of the people as well as the department, we couldn't, you know, make an change in the scenario of this conflict in Kashmir. So, you know, we started executing our immediate goals, and in first 2 years of our work in the valley, we rescued and released more than a dozen adult bear. Here you can see, you know, the veterinarian looking after the rescued bear. You can see the bear, how huge it is and how majestic it looks. The bears in this part of the world, these ascetic black bears, they can go up to the you know, size of weight of more than 200 kgs, and that is prominent from these pictures. There is a red-eyed slender turtle in my hand and the picture in the middle. So we started with doing rescues. There is a calf of the musk deer in the picture at the left-hand corner. A unique species of a snake, eastern cliff racer, which was rescued by me. Then a golden eagle at the on the right end of the corner. These are a few of the you know, rescues we took in. And yes, within first 3 years of our work, Wildlife SOS had already rescued and raised 5 abundant bear cubs, which aged less than a month at the time of the rescue. I can recall few of the incidents in which, you know, 2 of the bear siblings were rescued when their mother got killed in mob retaliation. And another incident in another part of the Kashmir, where mother bear was, she had taken refuge in, you know, in a hollow tree with her 2 cubs. But as soon as the people got the news, they ran after that bear, and, you know, maybe she was got killed. But when we intervened, we took those bear cubs in our custody, and till you know, now they are still in our rehabilitation center at Pahalgam. So since then, we are taking care of all these abandoned bears who has been the outcome of this human wildlife conflict. So here you can see a bear cub in our keeper's lap. Me taming an wild bear at our center. Yeah, these are few other bears who are you know, at our rescue centers, and yes, these bears too have been the conflicts, outcome of the human wildlife conflicts. Here you can see a brown bear, a majestic brown bear. You know, how majestic and how beautiful he is, I cannot define. Then our co-founder, Ms. Geeta Sheshmani, how she is comforting the bear cub in her lap. And then the picture of another bear who is at our Dachigam Rehabilitation Center. And this bear cub, this bear who is an adult now, it was also rescued in 2007 when it was just a week old. While executing our immediate goal of the capacity building, as I said that the department had the equipments, but their lack of expertise in the wildlife, handling and the rescue operations of wild animals, that was greatly hampering, doing the successful rescues. So specific tranquilizing workshops and other training workshops for the frontline staff were conducted in all the divisions of Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh. And while Wildlife SOS staff were rescuing the conflict animals, that proved to be the on-site exposure to the frontline staff of the department. And they were, acting as the live sessions for these frontline staff to learn from them and to learn the skills of handling the mob, tranquilizing the animal and safely, translocating the animal to the safer place. So the very objective of these trainings was to make the frontline staff capable of safely rescuing the wild animal in despair and also comforting the people of the place. So here, as you can see, giving them the insight about the guns, how they work, what kind of medicines they should use and what proportion of medicines they should use for an animal according to the weight and according to the size of the animal, giving them the exact, estimation of the distance of the animals and the humans so that they could intervene in the rescue operations. Here, you can also see from all these pictures, imparting them the trainings, trying them to be comfortable with the tranquilizing guns and taking the good shots. While, executing our immediate goals, while trying to achieve good from our immediate goals, we were also trying hard to head towards our long-term goals. We were working for education and awareness of common masses because we believe that education and awareness can help us to increase tolerance towards wildlife and that could help people avoid negative encounters with the wildlife. So that was very important, and although it's a big challenge, which indeed is difficult and time consuming, but this step is very important. This, thing is very important. We believe that our, mitigation efforts is motivated by a desire to identify paths towards conflict reduction and mitigation for the benefit of both people and wildlife. And we try to turn landscapes of conflict into landscapes of coexistence. That is the thing we aim to achieve. So while doing all these, we focus on four important points, which is awareness, a changing attitude of people, imparting skills to them so that they could participate, and you know, encouraging their active participation. Because though locals, you know, they were living wildlife for ages, but their knowledge about the behavior and ecology of the species is remarkably poor. They believe in many non-scientific ideas like, you know, all snakes are venomous. Black bears, you know, they kill to you know, consume the human flesh, or the leopards, they drink the human blood. So we try to eradicate all these myths from the people's mind and heart so that they could well connect with these wildlife. And you know, we believe that giving awareness, targeting the villagers will help in the coexistence between humans and wildlife. And it will definitely help in creating tolerance towards the wildlife, because education is the most powerful weapon which can be used to change the world. So education and training activities at different levels, at schools or in colleges or in adult education arenas, that will you know, help in developing innovative techniques, building local capacity, and giving practical skills to local populace, to villagers, and that they would in turn help them in better dealing with dangerous wildlife to effectively defend themselves, their crops, their livestock, and they could also raise the animal welfare as well. So thus, you know, giving them ample opportunities to participate in solving the issue and, you know, make a change in the scenario. So here you can see we are trying to impart the conservation, you know, conservation ideas to the school children, because we believe that these are the you know, these are the future of our valley, and these can be the best stewards of the conservation. So we are, you know, trying to prepare them to be the stewards of the wildlife in the future. And for this, doing these activities, we do classroom sessions, we do outdoor activities, we do competitive, you know, programs like painting, essay competition, seminars, debates, etc. And then we also observe, you know, various environment and wildlife related days and observances. So like these programs, as you can see, I'm trying to, you know, explain them the importance of the wildlife in the ecosystem. I try to explain to them why wildlife is important, what role we can play in their conservation, and what basically what are the basic you know, wildlife of our state. They at least they should have the knowledge about the wildlife we are having in the state, in this union territory. So our classroom sessions include three sessions, in fact, PowerPoint presentation, movie clips, and interactive session. In PowerPoint presentations, we have prepared a few PPTs, which, you know, give them the idea of the wildlife of the state and their importance, their behavior, and other things related to these wildlife. Then we have developed few movies, short movies, which can, you know, relate them to the environment, which can relate them to the issues which wildlife or nature or environment or as a whole biodiversity is facing in this part of the world, and how they can, you know, act positively to make this, you know, to make this environment better, and how they can play a role to give back to the nature in a positive manner. So these are very important. And then the last session, which is very important to us, that's an interactive session where we try to, you know, answer their queries, answer their whatever doubts they have in their mind regarding the wildlife of the state. Here, some more programs where we try to invite resource persons as well, because they are the best people who can, you know, sometimes give them the best answers and who can help them to play an effective role in making a change. These are some of the activities we conduct with the school children, with the college students. And this is the best part because, you know, these activities, they give the first-hand experience to these students about the nature, because when they go in the direct contact with the nature, they feel that warmth of the nature. They feel how much bestowed we are in form of biodiversity, in form of wild flora and fauna. And, you know, that makes them more eager to play a positive role towards the conservation of environment and wildlife. Here at the right hand of the corner, we are trying to, you know, do the live sessions with the students at our rescue centers, giving them the full knowledge of the behavior and, you know, all the things about the animals we have at our rescue centers. Few more of the outdoor activities with the school children. And then we organize, as I said, we organize competitive activities in which we try to give them a canvas and color so that they could, you know, paint whatever they feel about the nature and the biodiversity and the wildlife in particular. We give them a mic and a stage so that they could, you know, speak out their hearts about the feelings they have about the for the nature and the wildlife. Few more activities with the children. And yes, these are very important rallies and other special observances, because here we try to, you know, tell them that this is the time that when we have to join the hands and reach to more and more people with the message that this is the high time when we should try and work towards the conservation of the wildlife and the nature. Few more rallies with students and with the stakeholders of the society. These are, you know, few picture, one of the picture which in which I have tried to reach to the local masses, because, you know, bridging the gap between the masses and the concerned authorities is very important. This is the important step in which we try to meet with villagers and local communities. And in the second step, we try to make these people meet with the wildlife officials who are at the helm of, you know, addressing their grievances. So why these meetings? Because these meetings help us to, you know, take account of people's perception about the wildlife conservation. They help us to find the reasons behind the decrease, if there is any, in the population of the wild animals. And they help us to, you know, engrave the steps, take the idea of the steps they are taking to preserve this heritage. And bridging the gap between the wildlife official and the locals is very important. That interaction is very important because, as I said, that poor communication with the administration was often responsible for the negative attitude of, you know, people towards wildlife. So making this communication better was important. and efforts made to bridge this gap by organizing formal meetings where wildlife department officials responded to the queries of the local people. And they were very well taken because, you know, in these meetings, we used to explain different government policies and which helped the people to work towards well-being of wildlife. Here you can see a few of the pictures in which one of the elderly person, he is the head of the village. He was trying to impart the message to the people, and it is obviously every time very effective, because when you get a message from the elderly one, that always plays a positive role. A few more pictures with other stakeholders of the society, and women especially, where they can play a good role in the waste management, waste disposal management. What was the outcome of all these activities? Obviously, because, you know, when you work hard towards achieving any goal, that doesn't go waste. So yes, all these, hard works put in, the awareness and other things in the rescues, that paid us well in time. Change in people's perspective towards wildlife, we could see that because we get a number of increasing calls of the rescues, and that very well defines that, you know, people are have started believing in us, and they call us whenever they feel that they need our help. And yes, increasing tolerance towards wild animals, that have obviously increased, because now people they think twice before hitting any animal. In spite, they call us, they call the department for the intervention, for safely rescuing that animal from their habitations. Eradication of myths associated with wildlife, yes, we could eradicate that, and that is well, that could be well seen from their level of knowledge now. And spontaneous response from the general public upon wildlife sighting is, that's moving towards the right path, that's moving towards the positive manner, because whenever they sight an animal, they call us and we try to go to the place and try to rescue that animal. So in those rescue operations, people, in spite of attacking us, people in spite of making problems, they help us to rescue that animal safely. So that has also changed. And timely information on wildlife trafficking. Recently, a few of the incidents were indicative that, people are helping they help us to seize the contrabands and other things if they see any. And compassion of wild animals, that's very well seen in their deeds now. Encouraging people to support policies that protect wildlife, that could also be very well seen, because the number of volunteers we are getting, the number of blessings we are getting from the people is immense, and their support is immense. So that helps us to do something better in future. These are, we have prepared some awareness material, some flyers for public distribution, which gives them the idea what they should do if they sight any animal, what do's and don'ts they should follow to prevent the attacks. These are few more flyers which are printed in the local language so that people could read them. And this is a special flyer in which you can see the pictures. For these flyers, we hired an artist and we told him that we want this, that any illiterate person, the person who cannot read and write, he could get an idea that what we want to, you know, let him learn, like what should they do and what they should not do. Like, it is very evident from the pictures that whenever they go for the firewood, they should go in groups, they should well guard their livestock, they should not move singly, they should not take the shortcuts and other things. A few more awareness materials for public distribution, in which one of the flyer, it says about the, you know, importance of the wetlands, how it is, you know, why it is important and how it could help us to provide our future, for our future. And then there is another flyer at the right hand, which says about what kind of bins we should use in at homes and at hotel, you know, compounds, so that these could not be raided by the bears. And these bins could, you know, keep the animals away. Presently, Wildlife SOS is looking after two rescue centers. One is at Dachigam National Park and the other one is at Pahalgam. And we have 6 black bears and 2 brown bears at our rescue and rehabilitation centers. So we are also continuing with awareness and conservation programs and workshops for local communities and students. We are also conducting awareness programs with focus on identification of venomous snakes and first-hand measures which should be taken in case of snake bite, because we have seen in recent few years, 3-4 years, that a number of reptile rescue calls are increasing, because maybe there is some climatic changes which are responsible for the snakes to come out to the human habitations, or there may be some other reasons which we had to look for. So we are trying to conduct awareness regarding snakes of the valley. Then we are trying to develop leaflets for distribution at schools of different species of snakes we have in valley. Then obviously, yes, we are operating a dedicated helpline for rescuing of wildlife, especially reptiles, raptors, and other birds. During COVID pandemic also, when people, you know, had closed themselves inside their homes, we were out in the field, we were out at the roads trying to attend all the rescue calls we were getting. And we feel blessed that we could help people and wildlife in distress those times also. And we were able to rescue scores of reptiles, including various species of snakes and turtles as well, raptors, and other bird species, bears and leopards as well. But yes, lack of staff because of limited financial resources has always been a constraint towards conservation process of wildlife. So I humbly appeal you all to please chip in and help us doing better for the conservation of wildlife in this part of the world. So you can help us by sponsoring a black bear or a brown bear. You can help us sponsoring our daily rescue efforts. You can also support our outreach and awareness programs. That was all from my side. If there are any queries or any suggestions, you're welcome.
Thank you so much for the insightful presentation, Alia ma'am. We are so glad that all of us could tune into it and learn more about the Jammu and Kashmir project. We received a couple of questions during the course of the webinar, and I will be directing them one by one. To begin with, What can we do as civilians to reduce these human-animal conflicts, and how can we improve the current situation in Jammu and Kashmir in terms of conflict?
Yes, you can, you know, be the steward of conservation in your part of the valley, wherever you belong to. You can volunteer there. You can help us during the rescues, especially for the mob control. Whenever we go to the rescue sites, we often get, people who make problems, who create problems, or who want to take the situation in their hands. So yes, such volunteers are very important for us to, rescue the wildlife in those situations. And they can help us in the mob control, and they can help us to get the, first-hand information of the operations.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question is that these are actually two questions. So the first part being, are black bear fats or body parts still used as traditional medicine or for commercial trade?
Not in this part, not in Kashmir. But yes, in some of the parts of the world, it is still used. But as I said, that we always try to eradicate the myths from the people's mind and souls. This is one kind of a myth that, whenever the animal is killed, like black bear, as in this case, their fat that's used, their black gallbladder is used for the medicine, their paws are used because they are, delicacy for some people. Their nails are taken out because, people feel that they can keep the bad omen far away while keeping those, nails. So we are trying to eradicate these myths from the society. And yes, we have been able to do, to some extent, but we have to do more in this regard. And people like students and volunteers, they can help us in this regard also.
Thank you, ma'am. Also, in Jammu and Kashmir, what kind of approaches are viable at this moment? The behavioral approach, or are there any technological surveillance systems like camera trap or drones that are being used for conservation and conflict mitigation?
Sorry, Mahima, I couldn't get your question. The voice was breaking. Can you please repeat?
Certainly, ma'am. Ma'am, the question is, in Jammu and Kashmir, what kind of mitigation approaches are being viable at this moment? The behavioral approach or technological surveillance systems like camera trap or drones?
Every kind of a thing is, tried here. As I said, education and awareness have been a very effective tool in mitigating these man-animal conflicts. Then we can try some other methods also. But, not yet we have technical support. We have got any technical support. But yes, we are planning to use camera traps in one of the sites of Kashmir Valley, where we can, we are planning to, use the phase detection camera trap so that we could get an idea if the same bear is, repeatedly coming to the human habitations, or it is different bears every time. So that will help us to give an idea whether the bear is the same or it is different every time.
Right. Thank you so much for the detailed answer, ma'am. The next question is, why the snow leopards and bears are attacking humans? Is it because of poaching or due to scarcity of prey base?
It is definitely, due to scarcity of prey base. As I said, our jungles, they are thinning day by day because of the illegal trafficking of the timber. And then there are certain development policies which are taking place through the wildlife reserves or wildlife areas, which is responsible that these animals, they are straying away from their habitats to find, to look for the food and the shelter. That's why, they stray, and sometimes they accidentally come towards the human habitations. And whenever the people sight these animals, they either get, harmed in retaliation or they get killed.
Thank you, ma'am. We'll be taking the last question for the webinar. Are there any personal experiences that impacted you in your career to become a conservationist?
Yes, there is one incident which is, very tragic. It happened during, when I was just a student. And that, that incident urged me to do something for the mitigation of human-wildlife conflict in my part of the world, in my area. And that tragic incident, I still recall that it happened in Thral in 2007, where a bear was seen in the human habitation. It was not properly in the human habitation, but it was near the human habitation. And when the people saw the bear, they took, all, I don't know where the mob comes from, 10 different villages. And within minutes, there are hundreds and hundreds of people at the rescue site. I have seen this myself. So there were hundreds and hundreds of people with the axes, with the, sticks in their hands, and they were continuously attacking that animal. And, after stoning the animal, they put him on fire, and it was, burning alive. And that that was a tragic incident. Sorry, I'm a little, So that was the incident which was responsible for me turning from an educationist to the conservationist.
Thank you so much for your response. And we are glad that we have you as the true stalwart for change in the Kashmir region, and that you will continue to inspire many, many people. Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning into this webinar on the occasion of Earth Day. If we were unable to take your questions, please drop us an email with your question to wildside@wildlifesos.org, and we will get back to you with a response as soon as we can. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us tonight. Have a great day ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Stay safe and stay healthy.